मुख्यमंत्री श्री नवीन पटनायक नंदिनी स्वर्गीय नंदिनी शतपथी जो प्रतिमूर्ति उन्मोचन कले गवर्नर हाउस छक पाखे से तो मुझे एवं आमर स्थानीय विधायक बादल बाबू प्रियदर्शी बाबू तांकु निश्चय धन्यवाद जनईबी सहित कल्चर मंत्री श्री अशोक पंडा को भी मोर आंतरिक धन्यवाद निश्चित भाव जनईबी कारण नंदिनी शतपथी मोर माँ एवं भुवनेश्वर बासिंदा ओडिशावासी को धन्यवाद देवी जे युवशक्ति पुनर्बार नंदिनी शतपथी को चिन्हवापाई जो कार्य दरकार ता नवीन पटनायक ठीक जाणीकिरी उचित समय रे करुछंती कि ओडिशावासी को भुवनेश्वरवासी को एवं विशेषकर मुख्यमंत्री श्री नवीन पटनायक को मध्य धन्यवाद देवी नंदिनी शतपथी केवल मो माँ थी ता नुहे केवल मुख्यमंत्री थी ता नुहे सी जड़े साहित्यिका जड़े राजनीतिज्ञ जड़े प्रोग्रेसिव महिला जी कि गरीब लोकर चिंता करुले आज सरकार से भाव गरीब लोकर चिंता करुच्ची सर्वनिम्न स्तर में बंची ओडिया नागरिक चिंता करुच्ची ये कॉर्पोरेट सरकार नुहे ये बड़ बड़िया सरकार नुहे से कि जो चासी जो इरिगेशन प्रोजेक्ट जलसेचन प्रोजेक्ट जमी नंदिनी शतपथी आरंभ करते सेमती आज सरकार चाषी मान गरीब लोकों पर जलसेचन खटिखिया मूल्यापाई सेमती दृष्टि दौची मुझे कि भावुची जे ओडिशार भविष्य उज्जवल एवं आमे समस्ते मिसिकिरी कार्य कले ए राज्यर भविष्य ए राज्य एक नंबर राज्य रे निश्चित भाव में परिणत हबो
ओडिशा प्रथम महिला मुख्यमंत्री भाव में केवल नुहे साहित्य संस्कृति समाज सेवा क्रांतिकारी रचन रे तांकठारु बळी आ प्रतिभा जन्म हो कि नहीं मोर संदेह जेतेबेले से नेत्री थिले प्रथमे महिलार स्वाभिमान पाई नारीर सुरक्षा पाई तांकर निरंतर प्रयास जीवन शेष पर्यंत से जाहिर रखी थिले सांबादिकता क्षेत्र रे एक अनन्य दिगंत उन्मोचन करिवारे महान नेत्रींकर नेपथ्य भूमिका तांकु स्वीकृति देछि अनुवाद केवल साहित्य रे नुहे अनुवाद साहित्य रे केवल ट्रांसलेशन रे ट्रांसक्रिएशन रे से जड़े नेपथ्य नायिका थिले सेतेबेले तांकु एशियार सूर्य बोली कहा होतला राजनीति क्षेत्र रे जड़े महिला को तांकर एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन शिखिवार कथा सेतेबेले गरीब मेहनती मनुष्य पाई लड़े कर माँ टीए मुझे देखा पाऊना नमस्कार
आम सब शुणी पूर्वपुरुष पवित्र श्मशान देशर जातिर गौरव गान ଉଦ୍ଧରିବା ପାଇଁ କଲେ ତନୁକ୍ଷ ମାନବ ଜୀବନ ହୁଏ ସଫଳ। ଏ ମହା ଦୀକ୍ଷା କି ବୁଝିବ ଉତ୍କଳ। ଉତ୍କଳୀୟ ସଂସ୍କୃତି ହେଉଛି ପୂର୍ବପୁରୁଷଙ୍କର ସ୍ମୃତି ରକ୍ଷା କରିବା। ଏ ଅବହେଳା ପାଇଁ ଆମେ ଦାୟୀ, କାହାକୁ ନିର୍ଦ୍ଦିଷ୍ଟ ଭାବରେ ଦାୟୀ କରିବା କଥା ନୁହେଁ। ଯାହା ବହୁ ଆଗରୁ ହେବାର ଥିଲା ତାହା ହେଇପାରିନି, କିନ୍ତୁ ଆଜି ଆମେ ବେଶ ଖୁସି ଯେ କାର୍ଯ୍ୟ କରାଯାଇପାରିଲା। ତାଙ୍କ ପ୍ରତି ମର୍ଯ୍ୟାଦା ସମ୍ମାନ ଆମେ ପ୍ରଦର୍ଶନ କରୁଛୁ। ସେ କେବଳ ଓଡ଼ିଶାର ପୂର୍ବତନ ମୁଖ୍ୟମନ୍ତ୍ରୀ, ପ୍ରଦେଶ କଂଗ୍ରେସ କମିଟିର ପୂର୍ବତନ ସଭାପତି ନଥିଲେ ଆଦରଣୀୟ ବନ୍ଦନୀୟ ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀ, ସାରା ଦେଶରେ ତାଙ୍କ ପ୍ରତିଷ୍ଠା ଥିଲା। ମହିଳାମାନେ କିଭଳି ଭାବରେ ଆଗକୁ ବଢ଼ିପାରିବେ, ମହିଳା ସଶକ୍ତିକରଣର କଥା ଆମେ କହୁଛେ 70 ଦଶକ ଆରମ୍ଭରୁ, 60 ଦଶକର ଶେଷ ଭାଗରେ ସିଏ ବାଟ କଢ଼େଇଛନ୍ତି। ପୁରୁଷ ତାଙ୍କ ପଛରେ ଚାଲୁଥିଲେ, ସେ ହିଁ ପୁରୁଷ ପ୍ରକୃତରେ ଜଣେ ମରଦ, ସିଏ ତାଙ୍କ ମରଦ ପଣିଆ ଦେଖେଇଥିଲେ। ସେତେବେଳେ ଜଣେ ପ୍ରଗତିଶୀଳ ବ୍ୟକ୍ତିତ୍ୱ ସବୁ କ୍ଷେତ୍ରରେ ତାର ପ୍ରଭାବ ଅଛି, ଛାପ ଅଛି, ଶାସନରେ ଅଛି, ସାହିତ୍ୟରେ ଅଛି, ସଂସ୍କୃତିରେ ଅଛି, ବିକାଶରେ ଅଛି। ଆମେ ସେଥିପାଇଁ କହୁଥିଲୁ ଯେ ଢିଙ୍କିଶାଳରୁ ଢେଙ୍କାନାଳ ପର୍ଯ୍ୟନ୍ତ ସବୁଠି ସେ ନିଜର ପରାକାଷ୍ଠା ପ୍ରଦର୍ଶନ କରିଛନ୍ତି, ଏବଂ ପରପିଢ଼ି ପାଇଁ ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀ ସବୁବେଳେ ପ୍ରେରଣା ହୋଇ ରହିବେ।
ନମସ୍କାର। ଓଡ଼ିଶାର ଅନନ୍ୟା ପୁତ୍ରୀ, ମାଟିର ନନ୍ଦିନୀ, ଆମ ଜାତିର ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀଙ୍କ ଜନ୍ମ ଜୟନ୍ତୀ ଅବସରରେ ଆପଣମାନଙ୍କୁ ସମସ୍ତଙ୍କୁ ସାଦର ସ୍ୱାଗତ। ଶ୍ରୋତୃବୃନ୍ଦ, କାର୍ଯ୍ୟକ୍ରମ ଆରମ୍ଭରୁ ଆମେ ଆପଣମାନଙ୍କ ଉଦ୍ଦେଶ୍ୟରେ ପ୍ରସ୍ତୁତ କରୁଛୁ ସରୋଦ ବାଦନ। ଯେଉଁମାନେ ଧରିତ୍ରୀ ପରିବାରର ସଦସ୍ୟ ଆପଣମାନେ ସମସ୍ତେ ଜାଣନ୍ତି, ପ୍ରତିବର୍ଷ ଏ ଅବସରକୁ ଟିକେ ଆତ୍ମମଗ୍ନ କରିବା ପାଇଁ, ସଙ୍ଗୀତ ମୁଖର କରିବା ପାଇଁ ଏବଂ ସେଥିରେ ଟିକେ ନାନ୍ଦନିକତା ଭରିଦେବା ପାଇଁ ଆରମ୍ଭରୁ ହିଁ ଆମେ ଏମିତି ଏକ ଉପହାର ରଖିଥାଉ, କାର୍ଯ୍ୟକ୍ରମ ରଖିଥାଉ। ବିଶେଷ କରି ଖୋଜି ଖୋଜି ଯେଉଁମାନେ ଖୁବ୍ ବେଶୀ ପ୍ରଚାରିତ ନୁହନ୍ତି ଅଥତ୍ ପ୍ରତିଭାରେ ଅନନ୍ୟ ଏବଂ ଅସାଧାରଣ ତାଙ୍କୁ ଆପଣମାନଙ୍କ ସମ୍ମୁଖରେ ଆଣି ଭେଟ କରାଇଥାଉ। ସେହି ଧାରାରେ ଆଜି ଆମେ ନିମନ୍ତ୍ରଣ କରି ଆଣିଛୁ ଏମିତି ଜଣେ ଅତିଥି ବାଦକଙ୍କୁ, ଶିଳ୍ପୀଙ୍କୁ, ଯାହାଙ୍କୁ ଶୁଣିଲେ ଆପଣ ଚମତ୍କୃତ ତ ହେବେ, ଆନନ୍ଦିତ ହେବେ। ଏଇଥିପାଇଁ ଯେ ଶରଦ ବାଦନର ପରମ୍ପରା ବା ଶରଦ ଭଳି ଇଏ ଦେଶର ଦେଶର ଶାସ୍ତ୍ରୀୟ ସଙ୍ଗୀତର ଯେଉଁ ବିଶେଷ ବାଦ୍ୟଯନ୍ତ୍ର ଅଛି ତାକୁ ବଜାଇବା ପାଇଁ ଅନାଗ୍ରହର ଏ ସମୟରେ ସେହିଭଳି ଜଣେ ଶିଳ୍ପୀ ଆମ ଗହଣରେ ଅଛନ୍ତି, ଯିଏ ଶରଦ ବଜାଉଛନ୍ତି ଏବଂ ଶରଦ ଶିଖଉଛନ୍ତି ବି। ଆଜି ଆପଣମାନଙ୍କ ସମ୍ମୁଖକୁ କିଛି ସମୟର ଶରଦ ବାଦନ ପାଇଁ ନିମନ୍ତ୍ରଣ ଜଣାଉଛି ଆମ ରାଜ୍ୟର ଜଣେ ଅତ୍ୟନ୍ତ ପ୍ରତିଭାବାନ ଶରଦ ବାଦକ ଡକ୍ଟର ସନ୍ଦୀପ କୁମାର ରାଉତଙ୍କୁ। ଡକ୍ଟର ସନ୍ଦୀପ କୁମାର ରାଉତଙ୍କ ସହିତ ତବଲାରେ ସହଯୋଗିତା କରିବା ପାଇଁ ଉପସ୍ଥିତ ଅଛନ୍ତି ଆଉ ଜଣେ ଧୂରିଣ ତବଲା ବାଦକ କୁଳମଣି ସାହୁ। ଉଭୟ ଶିଳ୍ପୀଙ୍କୁ ମଞ୍ଚକୁ ସ୍ୱାଗତ କରୁଛି। ସାଂସ୍କୃତିକ ବୃନ୍ଦ, ସଙ୍ଗୀତର ଏ ଉପକ୍ରମଣିକା ପରେ ଆମେ ପ୍ରକୃତ ଉଦ୍ଦେଶ୍ୟକୁ ଏବେ ଫେରିବା। ନୂଆ ଓଡ଼ିଶାର ନିର୍ମାଣରେ ନିଜର ସ୍ୱତନ୍ତ୍ର ଅବଦାନ ରଖିଯାଇଥିବା ପ୍ରତିଟି ଓଡ଼ିଆଣୀଙ୍କ ପାଇଁ ଗର୍ବ ପାଲଟିଥିବା ଏବଂ ଓଡ଼ିଶାର ପ୍ରଗତିର ଇତିହାସରେ ନିଜର ଭୂମିକାକୁ ସ୍ୱର୍ଣ୍ଣାକ୍ଷରରେ ଲିପିବଦ୍ଧ କରିଯାଇଥିବା ଏ ମାଟିର ମହାନ କନ୍ୟା ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀଙ୍କ ଜନ୍ମବାସରରେ ଆମର ଏ ମିଳନ ଏବଂ ଏ ମିଳନ ପର୍ବକୁ ଆପଣମାନଙ୍କୁ ପୁଣି ଥରେ ସାଦର ସ୍ୱାଗତ। ମୁଁ ଆପଣମାନଙ୍କୁ ପୁଣି ଥରେ ଦୋହରାଇବାକୁ ହୁଏତ ଚାହିଁନଥାନ୍ତି, କିନ୍ତୁ ଲୋଭ ସମ୍ବରଣ କରିପାରୁନାହିଁ। ଆଜି ଯେଉଁଠି ବସି ଆମେ ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀଙ୍କ ସ୍ମୃତିଚାରଣ କରୁଛେ, ଇଏ ଜୟଦେବ ଭବନ ତାଙ୍କରି ସୃଷ୍ଟି। ପ୍ରଥମେ ଭୂମିହୀନକୁ ଭୂମି ପ୍ରଦାନ କରିବାର ଯେଉଁ ପରମ୍ପରା ଭାରତବର୍ଷରେ ଆରମ୍ଭ ହେଲା ସରକାରଙ୍କ ମାଧ୍ୟମରେ, ତାହା ସୃଷ୍ଟି ହୋଇଥିଲା ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଦେବୀଙ୍କ ମାଧ୍ୟମରେ। ପ୍ରଥମ ଥର ପାଇଁ ସମଗ୍ର ଭାରତବର୍ଷରେ ଯୌତୁକ ନିରୋଧ ଆଇନ ପ୍ରଣୟନ କରିଥିଲେ ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀ। ଓଡ଼ିଶାର କୃଷି ଏବଂ କୃଷକମାନଙ୍କୁ ସବଳ ସଶକ୍ତ କରିବା ପାଇଁ ଅପର କୋଲାବ ହେଉ ବା ରେଙ୍ଗାଲି ପ୍ରୋଜେକ୍ଟ ହେଉ, ଏସବୁ କାର୍ଯ୍ୟ ଆରମ୍ଭ ହୋଇଥିଲା ଏବଂ ଶେଷ ହୋଇଥିଲା ତାଙ୍କ ସମୟରେ। ଓଡ଼ିଶାର କଳାକାରମାନଙ୍କୁ ଏବଂ କବିମାନଙ୍କୁ ମଧ୍ୟ ଭୁଲି ଯାଇନଥିଲେ ସେ। ପାରମ୍ପରିକ କବିମାନଙ୍କର ପ୍ରସିଦ୍ଧ ଜଗନ୍ନାଥ ରଚନାକୁ ନେଇକରି ଗ୍ରାମଫୋନ୍ ରେକର୍ଡ଼ ହୋଇଥିଲା ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀଙ୍କ ଅମଳରେ। ଏବଂ ସବୁଠୁ ବଡ଼ କଥା ହେଉଛି, ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଶତପଥୀ ନିଜକୁ ନାରୀ ବା ପୁରୁଷ ବୋଲି ଭାବୁନଥିଲେ, ସେଇଥିପାଇଁ ସେ କେବେ ଚାହିଁନଥିଲେ ଯେ ମହିଳାଙ୍କ ପାଇଁ ସ୍ୱତନ୍ତ୍ର କୋଟା ରହୁ ଏବଂ କୋଟାର ଗଳି ବା ସିଡ଼ି ଚଢ଼ି ମହିଳାମାନେ ଉପରକୁ ଆସନ୍ତୁ। ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ସବୁବେଳେ ଚାହୁଁଥିଲେ ମହିଳାମାନେ ନିଜ ଶକ୍ତିରେ ଛିଡ଼ା ହୁଅନ୍ତୁ। ଏବଂ ସୁଖର କଥା, ଆଜି ଏ ଅବସରରେ ଯେଉଁ ଦୁଇ ବିଶିଷ୍ଟ ମହିଳାଙ୍କୁ ଆମେ ଅତିଥି ରୂପେ ପାଇଛେ, ଜଣଙ୍କୁ ମୁଖ୍ୟ ଅତିଥି ରୂପେ ଏବଂ ଆଉ ଜଣଙ୍କୁ ମୁଖ୍ୟ ବକ୍ତା ରୂପେ, ଏ ଉଭୟ ହେଉଛନ୍ତି ଶକ୍ତିର ଉଦାହରଣ। ଏବଂ ନିଜ ଗୋଡ଼ରେ ନିଜେ କେମିତି ଛିଡ଼ା ହୋଇ ହୁଏ ଏବଂ ଅନ୍ୟମାନଙ୍କୁ ହାତ ଧରି ଛିଡ଼ା କରି ବାଟ ଚଲେଇ ହୁଏ, ତାର ଉଦାହରଣ ହେଉଛି ତାଙ୍କର ଜୀବନୀ। ମୁଁ ମଞ୍ଚକୁ ସ୍ୱାଗତ ଜଣାଇବି ଆଜି ସନ୍ଧ୍ୟାର ମୁଖ୍ୟ ଅତିଥି, ପ୍ରସିଦ୍ଧ ଆଡ଼ଭୋକେଟ୍, ସୁପ୍ରିମକୋର୍ଟର, ଭାରତବର୍ଷର ଜଣେ ସମ୍ମାନନୀୟ ମହିଳା କରୁଣାନନ୍ଦୀ ମହୋଦୟଙ୍କୁ ସ୍ୱାଗତ ଜଣାଉଛି। ପ୍ରସିଦ୍ଧ ଆଡ଼ଭୋକେଟ୍, ସମାଜକର୍ମୀ ଏବଂ ଲେଖିକା ଫ୍ଲାଭିଆ ଏଗ୍ନେସ୍କୁ, ଏବଂ ସ୍ୱାଗତ କରୁଛି ମଞ୍ଚକୁ ଧରିତ୍ରୀ ତଥା ଓଡ଼ିଶା ପୋଷ୍ଟର ସମ୍ପାଦକ ଶ୍ରୀଯୁକ୍ତ ତଥାଗତ ଶତପଥୀ ମହୋଦୟଙ୍କୁ, ଆମ ଅତିଥିମାନଙ୍କୁ ମଞ୍ଚକୁ ପଛକୁ ଆଣିବା ପାଇଁ। ମୁଁ ଅନୁରୋଧ କରିବି ଶ୍ରୀଯୁକ୍ତ ଶତପଥୀ ମହୋଦୟଙ୍କୁ ଆମ ଅତିଥିମାନଙ୍କୁ ପ୍ରଦୀପ ପ୍ରଜ୍ୱଳନ କରି ପ୍ରଥମେ ଆମେ ଏ ସମାରୋହକୁ ଉଦ୍ଘାଟନ କରିବା। ମୁଖ୍ୟ ଅତିଥି ଏବଂ ମୁଖ୍ୟ ବକ୍ତା ତଥା ସମ୍ପାଦକ ସାଂସଦ ଶ୍ରୀଯୁକ୍ତ ତଥାଗତ ଶତପଥୀଙ୍କୁ ଅନୁରୋଧ। ପ୍ରଭୁ ଶ୍ରୀ ଜଗନ୍ନାଥ, ଶ୍ରୀ ମା ଶ୍ରୀ ଅରବିନ୍ଦ ଏବଂ ନନ୍ଦିନୀ ଦେବୀଙ୍କ ପ୍ରତିମୂର୍ତ୍ତି ନିକଟରେ ପ୍ରଦୀପ ପ୍ରଜ୍ୱଳନ କରି ଏବଂ ପୁଷ୍ପାର୍ଘ୍ୟ ଅର୍ପଣ କରି ଏ ସମାରୋହକୁ ଉଦ୍ଘାଟନ କରିବା ପାଇଁ। ଆଜି ମାଆଙ୍କ ଦିନ, ମାଆଙ୍କ ଦିନ ତ ସବୁଦିନ, ତେବେ କାର୍ଯ୍ୟକ୍ରମ ଆରମ୍ଭରେ ମଦର୍ସ ମ୍ୟୁଜିକ୍। धन्यवाद। मु आपण मानक जो मानक सम्मुखरे देखुची प्राय आपण माने समस्ते धूरिण विज्ञ एवं मोठु अधिक सचेतन अतए आज अतिथि मानक सहित आपण को परिचय करिवार विशेष दृष्टता मु करिबे नाही। तेबे पारंपरिकता दृष्टि एतिकि कहिबि करुणा नंदी बाहरे पाठ पढ़िले लंडन रे बार रे सारा जीवन से बीते दे पारि थांते किंतु गोटे समय रे तांको लागिला जे ना मो जगह लंडन हार्वर्ड नुह कि कोलंबिया यूनिवर्सिटी नुह मो जगह होची भारत। भारत मते डाकुची एवं भारत रे बहु किछि कार्य करिवार अछि एवं से भारत आसिले। भारत आसिला परे कंपानी अफेयर्स हो बा महिला मानकर शिशु मानकर विभिन्न समस्या हो ताकु नुआ रूप रे देखी एवं से आईनी रो केमिति अन्य माने सुजोग नहीं परिबे सेति प्रति से एपर्यंत अनवरत कार्य करी चली चंती एवं करुणा नंदी केवल आडवोकेट मानक पई नहो महिला मानक पई आज गोटे मशाल गोटे उज्ज्वल मशाल ही जळुचंती एवं अन्य माने तांको द्वारा आलोकित होउचंती तांको स्वागत करूची पुनि थरे फ्लाविया एग्नेस बाहाबा पर्यंत खाली मैट्रिक पढ़ी जीवन रे दुर्घटना आसला पीड़ा आसला जंत्रणा आसला निर्जातना आसला भाविले बंधन रु मुकुली जीवे मुकुली पारिले नहीं डाइवर्स हो पारा ना विभिन्न कारण पुणी भाविले ये कौन मुत बची बचवा पड़ब आठ वर्ष पर एमए पढ़िले सोशियोलोजी रे लॉ कले डिग्री हासिल कले एवं मजलिस बोली गोटे संस्था तैयारी कले जो संस्था आज पर्यंत 5000 रु अधिक महिला को सुरक्षा दे परिची शक्ति दे परिची एवं सेमान को निज जीवन सहित सेमान को परिचित करी परिची जने विशिष्ट एडवोकेट हवा सहित जने विशिष्ट समाजकर्मी मध्य से हे परिचंती एवं तांको आत्मजीवनीमूलक पुस्तक माय स्टोरी आवर स्टोरी ऑफ रीबिल्डिंग ब्रोकन लाइफ्स भारतवर्षर अनेक भाषा आज अनुदित स्वागत जनाऊँ आपण मान समस्त तरफ़ आपण को उभयू स्वागत एवं अनुरोध करुच्ची ये सब आयोजन नायक धरित्री तथा ओडिशा पोस्टर संपादक मान्यवर सांसद श्रीजुक्त तथागत शतपथी महोदय को आपण मान प्रारंभिक स्वागत संभाषण देवाई श्रीजुक्त शतपथी महोदय
समस्त को मोर प्रणाम नमस्कार जोहार। आई एम हाईली ओब्लाइज्ड एंड एक्सट्रीमली प्लीज्ड दैट दिस इवनिंग वी हैव अमंगस्ट अस टू एक्सट्रीमली वेल नोन एंड आई वुड से टू लेडीज हु हैव फॉट एंड मेड अ मार्क फॉर देमसेल्व्स in their own careers, in their lives. We welcome them to Orissa, to Bhubaneswar, and to this function of to mark the birth anniversary of late Nandini Satpathy. The subject that we dared to give these two learned ladies, which we thought of, was titled Rule of Law, Has It Led to Misrule? And while thinking of the subject, we were also confused ourselves, like how will it be presented, what exactly is it that we want our speakers to dwell on? What little I understand when I see life and see politics and see how powerful people run the government, both at the center and the states, I realize that what is termed as civil society, a society can be called civil primarily, what I understand, maybe I'm completely off track, primarily because it has a law, and to implement that law, it has an order machinery. Or to bring it down to cruder terms, you have the courts, you have the constitution, you have the statute books, you have whatever, everything under one umbrella called law. And to implement that, you have, let's put it very succinctly, you have the police, the cops. So a society that has these two balancing factors can be called a civil society. And a society that does not possess these two qualities, we would possibly call it jungle raj, barbaric society, or a wild country or a wild society. We have, what little again I have seen, we as a nation, Indians, we have been subjugated for too long. There were the Afghans, there were the Mughals, there were the British, but much prior to that, before the Dutch and the French and the British and the Mughals and the Afghans, we have had forces, alien forces, who have come and ruled over and, well, I would not say rule over, but they have overrun us, overrun this subcontinent, and have exploited us, looted us, plundered us. And we have been more or less in the past at not such an united society, so we have been defenseless. So law, as something put down on us, has always been alien to us. It's not something that is born from us. It is not something that has been created by us. It was some alien ruler who put it on to us. And we were forced to abide by this alien regulation. So when some individual decided to become disobedient, disobedience and dereliction of duty, of law, everything became or made the person, that individual, a hero at home. When he went back to his parents, when he went back to his wife or his children or his friends, they considered that here comes a hero who has opposed the very essence of administration, the very essence of government, and somebody who has dared to stand up against the might of the state. So in that kind of a society, it was admired if you stood up against the might and the brutality of society. It is possible, again, this is a weird thought, it is possible that a great leader like Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, his major plank was civil disobedience. He probably understood that we as a nation, Indians, always, it is there inborn in us, we were always disobedient as a nation. So he used our weakness, he used our aberration in our characters to channelize it in such a way that it completely confused and it completely put the Western rulers in a confused state. They didn't know what was happening. They were prepared for guns. They were prepared for battle. They were prepared for people to fight them. But they didn't understand when people didn't fight them, when people didn't hit back at them, people didn't throw stones at them, people didn't give speeches. So the civil disobedience movement probably is something that grew from Gandhi's understanding of our inherent character of being disobedient. Probably, this is just an abstract thought. Now, as a politically independent, and I'm underlining politically, now as a politically independent nation, our genes, our DNA, my DNA, all of us as Indians, our DNA is yet to accept that these laws that we are making are actually creations of our own. Some of us have somehow, through a system of democracy, through votes, through different means, but primarily vote is at the base, have elected our representatives, who in turn have elected a few people to govern us, and they are the ones, parliament, assembly, they are the ones who create the law. And on the other side, you have the courts, you have the government system, which is implementing it, interpreting it. So, law of the land, as we understand, is something that is being created by us now, but we are unable to notice the change, that something was alien earlier, now it is something inherent, we are creating it. I see in Parliament how scores of so-called archaic laws are being scrapped. Government tells us that these are laws that are not required in this date and time. That is very welcome. And law, as we understand, is not something limited to only the constitution or statute books, because those are documents, they are fixed. It is up to the human element, it is up to the courts, it is up to the judges, it is up to the lawyers, it is up to civil society to interpret them. So a constitution, when people say it is not written in the constitution, constitution is not something living, it's not an entity which is alive, it is something dead. Or dead would not be the right word. It is something that is not living, non-living object. How we interpret it gives it a life. So, lot of laws are being scrapped nowadays. Therefore, in this background of a country that has never seen law as being something inherent and part of its population and its people throwing up something as law for their own requirement, for their own need, the situation, the scenario has changed, and now we are making laws which we are supposed to be needing. Therefore, has this new situation, the rule of law, has it led to misrule, is what we would like to hear from a very renowned and from our very able speakers, who should tell us what is their perspective, especially from, I am not saying feminist, but from a woman's point of view, what is their perspective. We have also tried to change the format a little bit. Each of our speakers has been requested to speak for 20 minutes. After 20 minutes, we will have young volunteers on both sides with paper and pen. And if any of you, ladies and gentlemen, like to ask a question, we would request you to please raise your hand. Our volunteers will give you the paper and pen. Please write the speaker's name, whom you want to specifically put the question to. Write the question in clear handwriting. Put your name and your mobile number, and we will shortlist 6 questions, 3 for each of the speakers, and they will have an opportunity to elucidate, to clarify, if they wish to, on any of the points that trouble you, let's put it that way. So therefore, I will not prolong too much. I thank you all for this great evening. I will thank you again at the end of it. But right now, I am also thanking you for being so patient. And my only request is kindly switch off your mobile phones or put it on silent mode. And the second request is nobody should leave when our speakers are speaking. You can leave once the speakers finish. And that is where I will come to stop my blabbering. Thank you.
धन्यवाद श्रीयुक्त शतपथ महोदय एबे आमे प्रथमे शुणिबा आज मुख्य वक्ता विषय वस्तु संपर्क रे श्रीयुक्त शतपथ महोदय आपण मन को सूचना दे सारी आमे संभवतः इंग्राजी भाषा रे ही शुणिबा एवं संभवतः आपण माने समस्त इंग्राजी भल रूपे बुझिपारे श्रीयुक्त शतपथी भाषण समय आपणकर जो प्रतिक्रिया आम शुणा पाथलु से बुझा पड़ू इंग्राजी हेले आपन को असुविधा होनी एवं ये विषय नहीं आपण माने समस्ते उत्साहित अच्छा कारण प्रकृत केमिति केमिति लगुच गोटे अराजकता आड़क आम मुहाई जाऊचे जो मुहरे जाऊचे आमको नि आईनर आश्रय नहीं बा आईनर सहायता नहीं आईनर हाथ बहुत लंबा बोली आम शुणी आसीचे एवं से हाथ केते दूर अराजकता आड़क नौ ना से हाथ पुणी साड़ू टाणी आनी आमको पुणी श्रृंखला भितर रख शांति भितर रख से कथा आम पर शुणा मु अनुरोध करी आज मुख्य वक्ता फ्लाविया एग्नेस महोदय को वक्तव्य रखापी
Good evening, everyone. I am very happy to be here, delivering a memorial lecture in honor of someone I have always admired as a child, as growing up, as a law student, as a lawyer. Means we always hear about the Nandini Satpathy case, where certain human rights aspects were litigated in the court and won. And I think that is very important for us as lawyers. That one of the most important, one of the important cases in this realm of protecting the rights of the accused, and what are the boundaries that must be drawn when the state is litigating against a civilian? And I think when Mr. Satpathy invited me and told me that it's a memorial lecture, I was overwhelmed and I was very happy to accept this invitation. And I'm very happy to be here in a land where. Prabhu Jagannath's temple is there at Puri, Konark is there, several of these monuments are there, and the ruled by gods and goddesses who are so enduring. One is ancient, one is the whole grandeur of it, but also the endearment, like something very dear, a very human like god who has all the rituals of humans. And I think it's a wonderful feeling to be here and to be part of this culture and to be part of this narratives. So I'm extremely happy. Mr. Satpathy has given us a theme which can be interpreted in any way we want. In fact, I asked him what exactly you would like us to speak or like me to speak, and he said whatever you want. He said the ground is open. And they also told me about the last year's event, which was very heated, controversy was there. So I thought that, you know, we must have a certain element of excitement and controversy this year also. So there are many issues I could talk about, but I'll give you a brief introduction about myself and my organization. I'm in Mumbai. We have a small organization called Majlis, and the Majlis Legal Center essentially provides support to women in all their litigation issues in the trial court, whether it is a question of obtaining divorce, maintenance, other rights, domestic violence, sexual abuse, etc. In fact, sexual abuse is a program that we have started more recently in 2011. From the time of filing the FIR till the end of the case, what kind of support would that victim need in order to become a survivor? And I think that's a very important program. So in that process, we come to know who are the victims, who are the abusers, and what happens in the court. And it would fit very well in the theme of why we have the laws, how these laws are implemented, how do they go down to our police stations, and what exactly happens in a court of law. And that was one issue we could really talk about. because we have very ground level experience of that. But I choose not to speak on that. I'll speak on something else. And that is this whole debate, entire debate on the enactment of the Uniform Civil Code. What is the Uniform Civil Code? Why do we need it? And we also hear a lot about the Muslim law, how bad the Muslim law is. The triple talaq controversy is raging in the country. Muslim women one side, secular groups along with the Muslim women, the Muslim Personal Law Board on the other side. There are lots of these gender versus community tensions we are living through. I do not know how much of it is here in Orissa, but if you see Delhi, Bombay newspapers, they are full of this news. So I do not want to talk about also Uniform Civil Code or Muslim law, but I want to talk about something which is more relevant to us and which we experience every day. And that is, as Mr. Satpathy said, we have a constitution. We have a constitution as a guiding principle. I wouldn't say it's a dead constitution, it's a living constitution. And it expands every day, gives us rights. We also have the Hindu Marriage Act. And both these are now more than 6 decades old. So where has it taken us as Hindus? As a Hindu society governed by the rule of law, we have a law that is there for all of us. And it is supposed to transform the Hindu society. There was a lot of debate for 15 years to bring this law as against the opposition from the conservative forces. So we declare ourselves as Hindus as a progressive society. We have reformed our law. Unfortunately, most of us Hindus do not know our law. Unless we have a problem, we live by a culture. How we get married, how the rituals are performed, more or less we're still into our culture. And that cultural space is a very sacrosanct. And for me, Puri and Jagannath temple in a way emblemizes that. That this is our God made out of our own culture, made out of our own civilization, and that's what we worship and that's what we live by. I'll give you only one example. Similarly, I come from South India. I come from Karnataka. So we have a lot of traditions. We have different rituals. First cousins marrying each other, uncle and nephew marrying each other. You know, lots of these pluralistic society. And into this pluralistic society, we have one law. That's called the Hindu Marriage Act. So I just want to flag a few issues. And where are we today? Because if we had one law that was working well, then I could say, yes, that law is very good. And all of us, minorities, Christians, Muslims, must follow that law. Because that law gives rights to women. So I would just want to, without being too controversial, I just want to flag a few issues. So what this law brought about? It brought about, it abolished child marriage. It prescribed an age for marriage. And in 1976, that age was 18 years for girls and 21 for boys. It abolished polygamy. And in 1955, all Hindus were supposed to be monogamous. One man, one wife. It had, it gave women property rights. That women, first as daughters, and hopefully their wives, but that is not there, they will have equal rights as against the brothers. It made Hindu marriage contractual. So Muslim marriage is always contractual. After that, Christian marriage became contractual. But now Hindu marriage is contractual. We have contractual rights and obligations. And if those are obligations are not fulfilled, we have an exit point. We can opt for divorce. Now, all these came about. And I want to see where are we today. When we say Muslim law is bad and Muslim law doesn't work, the presumption is Hindu law is good and it has worked. And I speak to you as a lawyer representing Hindu women in the courts. That's my major area of work, and my entire team works on that. So let's take simple issues. Firstly, let us take the most controversial issue of polygamy. One man, one wife. He must not have more than one wife. So what do? We know our society is not polygamous, and it's not monogamous. Our cultural traditions, one wife here, one wife there, one kept woman here, one affair somewhere, has it really stopped by this law? Or has it continued? And according to me, it has continued. The statistics that were there, like in 70s, that came about, showed that there are more average, statistically, more Hindus have polygamous marriages than Muslims. But Muslims are only 12%. Hindus are a large majority. So actual numbers, the numbers are staggering. Of Hindu men marrying more than one wife, but we are not talking about affair. We are not talking about a kept woman, a concubine, a mistress. We're talking about wives. I come from the state of Maharashtra. So in Maharashtra, if you see, we have a term called Rakel. We have kept her. And this is used legally in the court. A woman goes to ask for maintenance. Husband says, she's not my wife. Actually, I have my wife in the village. And I've kept her. She's my wife. I have children through her. But she's not actually my wife. So what happens to her when this happens? So Hindu marriage says only one man and one woman. So where does this woman, this law leaves this woman? Because as before 1955, Hindu law was polygamous. And all our gods, goddesses, everybody had more than one wife or husband. And we are used to that culturally. So suddenly we have a monogamy. And according to me, monogamy was Western, Christian, European. And we brought it in India. We brought it in Delhi. We had the law. Where does it go? Has it gone up to our villages? Has it gone to our towns? Has it gone to our civilized society? We have Hema Malini and Dharmendra. And they are Rajya Sabha members. For a rule of law, sir, for you. We have no problem at all. We have Karuna Nidhi. We have Ram Jethmalani. But they are all older. But now you have many, many more all the time happening. And we acclaim them. We never chastise somebody because he has got more than one wife. If he has got the money, if he has the clout, if he has got the political influence, that's rule of law for you. That is exactly how it works. But let's look at the women. Fortunately, none of these have, Hema Malini never wanted maintenance. So they said, if you don't have maintenance, it's okay. Only when you go for maintenance is a problem. So she has enough money. She has the children. He has his children from the first wife. There's no problem at all. But if she went to court saying that I want money from this man out of whom I have two children, the court will say, no, 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 you are not his real wife because he has not divorced his first wife and married you. You are a kept woman. If it doesn't matter to her, but it matters to hundreds of my clients. And when they go to court and they don't get maintenance, who has got the advantage of this? That you brought in monogamy. You brought in monogamy to protect women. But whom has he given advantage? That earlier, the man would have to give maintenance to every wife. He could not say that she's not my wife, she's my kept woman. But now, he has to give maintenance to only one wife. So even if he has discarded the first wife, he will bring her to court and say, this is my wife. And she will also say, yes, she'll be very happy, husband has come back to her. And who is denied? Firstly, the denied is the second wife and her children. But fortunately, the child rights has advanced. So now there is no concept of legitimacy and illegitimacy. He has to provide for every child of his, whether it is through legal marriage or illegal marriage. Who it has left behind? It has left behind women. Who gets punished for the polygamy of the marriage is the woman. She has no rights. So finally, we enacted a law called Domestic Violence Act, and we brought in a concept called live-in relationship. And we thought we had overcome the problem. We said, okay, Hindu marriage is this, but now we can recognize live-in relationship. In 2011, we got a Supreme Court ruling on this, and we said, no, the judge said nothing doing. He is contracted to marry one wife. He cannot contact another wife. And that woman will only be a mistress. And that judgment refers to these women as concubines, as keeps, as mistresses. And that is how we have advanced. I'll give you another statistics. Sir, you have to really stop me because I can go on this topic. When my time is up, you just take me. You have 3 minutes. So child marriage. We have recent statistics. A staggering number of children are getting married. And they said this number of children who are getting married is as much as the population of Jammu and Kashmir. That many children are married, many of them under 10 years. Now, subsequent report came, 84% are Hindus. So we say Muslim law is not codified. Muslim law, there is no prevention of child marriage. But who is getting their children married young? Where is it? It is like census statistics, I'm telling you. That 84% of a child marriage are among Hindu families. And this is something that came up like recently, about a week or 2 weeks ago. Now, marriage is a contract. Now, we see among Hindus, we are equal, men and women. We contract as equals, and we have equal rights and obligations. But we do still do Satvera. We still do Kanyadan. You know what's Kanyadan? I don't know whether it is observed in this region, but most of Hindus are supposed to give your daughter in marriage. It's called Sahalankar Kanyadan, that a bedecked girl is offered to the groom as a Brahmin. And that we offer our girls, and after that, a girl is dead to the family, native family. She has to stay there only. She has to live there or she has to die there. And now when she says she wants to ascertain her rights, what do a court say? A court say, among the Hindus, the husband is the Pati Parameshwar. She's supposed to worship him. She's supposed to do his puja, and that is Hindu dharma for us. This is what our courts are telling us. So one level we have Hindu marriage as contract. So at the same time, the husband as a lord and master, we have never really gone away from it. And we have never gone away from society, but we have not even gone away from it from law. That when she says that she wants to ascertain her rights of working, her rights of earning, he says, if he says you cannot work, then you cannot work. Because after all, he will determine. The home is, he's the owner, and he's the owner of you. And this is what Hindu law, actually, one level we have a contract, and one level we have a sacramental obligation, which is given to us under the traditional Hindu law. Then we have dowry, Dowry Prohibition Act. Then we made certain laws in our IPC called dowry death, suicide, for harassment of dowry, and we had murder. There are three different laws where the women have died, and we have 498A. Dowry, cruelty to wives. We have all these laws, and we brought them about in 1980s onwards. Lot of laws. Even today, if you really see the cases, case law, which goes to Supreme Court or in the High Court, 98% are Hindus. Only 2% are others. So where does this actually prevail? This is a Hindu, he has dowry. And recently there was an article that married women commit suicide. In India, maximum. In other countries, marriage is supposed to be a protection. Married people do not commit suicide. But in India, married women commit suicide. So marriage, as a place of depression, as a place where women have no rights. Because marriage as a sacrament, you're supposed to be with that husband. He's violent, he's this, he's that. But courts are inaccessible. Lawyers are expensive. You go for counseling, you are sent back. You go to the same house, and after some time, you commit suicide. Because the state has failed you. The law has failed you. And you do not know where else to turn. Your parents are not supporting. The police are not supporting. The courts are not supporting. And this is again a very blatantly Hindu violation. You may challenge me on this, but I'm speaking to you from statistics. I wonder, if time is up, then I will come to the last issue, is honor killing. It's basically caste violence. In Maharashtra, we have a film that's going, popular Marathi film called Sairath. Now, Sairath as a Marathi film has grossed 100 crores and is going to go much ahead. A very popular film. The Maratha community, it is on Maratha community and a Dalit boy. It's a traditional love story, and honor killing happens. Now, we think honor killing is Haryana. We think honor killing is North Indian. We never really thought it's in Maharashtra or Karnataka. And with this film, a lot of statistics are coming up that how upper caste Hindu society, how violent it is towards its own daughters. And how any boy of the lower class who falls in love with a girl from the Maratha family, and what fate awaits him, but more important, what they do to their own daughter. Each of these honor killing cases are committed by the girl's family, and a girl's body is cut to pieces and the boy's body is cut to pieces. And it is thrown in the river, thrown in the stream, thrown in the fields. And that is how violent natal family can be. We have seen in dowry death how marital family can be. And in honor killing, we can see how brutally violent the girl's own family can be. Now, these are all the issues that are confronting us, apart from issues of maintenance, issues of desertion, where the husband deserts the first wife and then he starts living with another woman. And that woman, in Marathi again, we have a term called paritatyavrat, that she is the discarded woman. We also have son preference and the way we treat our girl children. Again, in Maharashtra, there is a term for girls called nakusa. That means she's the unwanted child. And there is a belief that if we term our daughter nakusa, then next you will get a boy. God will bless you with a boy. Because boy is so important. Boy is so important for the last rights, for property rights, for various kind of things. A Hindu family must have a boy. So did the law, in fact, change any of this at all? Did it change our beliefs? It may have changed a little bit in urban areas. Has it gone down to our villages? Has it gone to our district towns? Has it gone to our rural areas? Or are we still caught in the same culture, same tradition? And I'm not against culture and tradition. I'm only for women's rights. And the culture and tradition was not so anti-women prior to the British era. There were much more community practices that were for women, in favor of women, including when you marry a second wife, what are the rights of the first wife and the second wife and the husband. In fact, Karunanidhi, when he married the second wife, he had to do something called Patni Bhagam. That means of the property, it is divided three ways, one for the husband, one for the first wife, and one for the second wife. Today, the culture continues, you marry, but the second woman is left high and dry. So you temper with tradition, you temper with culture, you bring in a law, and then what happens when the patriarchy prevails so strongly is women are left without tradition, without culture, without law, and without rights. And I think when we have a debate on why we should have a uniform civil law or why Muslim law is so bad, it is important as a predominant Hindu community for us to reflect where has our law gone, where have we gone in terms of rights, where all we have created spaces for our women, for their rights, for their property rights, for their safety, for their security. And if we have not done that, on what basis are we saying there should be a uniform civil code for others? Because we always see others. You know, Muslim law is bad. Muslim men have four wives. Muslim men have child marriage. Muslim men have something else. But what does Hindu society have? We never say dowry is a Hindu problem. We do not see honor killing as a Hindu problem. We do not see girl preference as a Hindu problem. These are the problems of the Hindu society. And unless we address them as Hindus, and as Hindus who are using law to transform culture, tradition, and to protect women, I don't think we can go very much further into this. We may have more laws, and more laws that don't work. So where rule of law is there, and continuously a misuse of law happens. So I end here. Thank you very much.
Dhanyavaad. Madam Agnes. Apanmanaka avastha kon hela ke jani mu janini. କିନ୍ତୁ ମୁଁ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଶୁଣୁଥିଲି ମୁଁ ଭାବୁଥିଲି କ'ଣ ଆମେ ଏମିତି ଗୋଟେ ସମାଜରେ ଅଛେ ସତରେ ଅଛେ ପୁଣି ମନେ ପଡ଼ୁଛି ସେଇ ଛୋଟ କଥାଟି ଯାହା ଆମେ ସମସ୍ତେ ଜାଣିଛେ ସମସ୍ତେ କୁହେ ଛୁରୀଟି ଅଛି ଏବଂ ବଳଶାଳୀମାନେ ଚତୁରମାନେ ସେ ଛୁରୀଟିରେ ଯାହା କରିବା କଥା ତାଙ୍କ ହିସାବରେ କରୁଛନ୍ତି ଯଦିଓ ଛୁରୀଟି ତିଆରି ହୋଇଥିଲା ଅସ୍ତ୍ରୋପଚାର ପାଇଁ ଆଇନର ଅବସ୍ଥା ମଧ୍ୟ ସେଇଆ ହେଇଛି ଏବଂ ଜଣେ ବିଖ୍ୟାତ ଲୋକ କିଏ କହିଥିଲେ ଯେ ଦୁନିଆରେ ଯେପର୍ଯ୍ୟନ୍ତ ମୂର୍ଖମାନଙ୍କ ସଂଖ୍ୟା ବଢ଼ି ଚାଲିଥିବ ବା ବହୁ ସଂଖ୍ୟାରେ ଥିବେ ସେ ପର୍ଯ୍ୟନ୍ତ ଏ ଚତୁରମାନେ ଏବଂ ଧୂର୍ତ୍ତମାନେ ଶାସନ ସବୁବେଳେ କରୁଥିବେ ଏବଂ ଶାସନକୁ ନିଜ ଢଙ୍ଗରେ ଚଳାଉଥିବେ ଏବଂ ତାରି ଫଳ ବୋଧେ ହେଉଛି ଏଇଆ ଯେଉଁଥିପାଇଁ ଆଇନ ଅଛି କିନ୍ତୁ ଅରାଜକତା ଆଡ଼କୁ ମୁହାଁଉଛି ଆଶା କରିବା ମଧ୍ୟ ଆପଣମାନେ କିଛି ପ୍ରଶ୍ନ ପଚାରିବେ ତେବେ ତା ପୂର୍ବରୁ ଶୁଣିବା ଆଜିର ମୁଖ୍ୟ ଅତିଥି କରୁଣାନନ୍ଦୀଙ୍କୁ ମୁଁ ଅନୁରୋଧ କରିବି श्रीमती करुणा नंदी तांकर वक्तव्य रखिबे एवं आपण माने तांको बुझंतु कि न बुझंतु परवर्ती 20 मिनिट अंततः स्तब्ध होई देखिबे ये विश्वास मु रखुछि। श्रीमती करुणा नंदी
नमस्कार। एहा मोर प्रथम थरो ओडिसा रे अध्यक्षा अध्यक्षा तथागत इनको सहित आपन मानू धन्यवाद। शुक्रिया। आई एम डीपली ऑनर्ड टू बी हियर एंड आई एम डीपली ऑनर्ड बिकॉज वी आर सेलिब्रेटिंग टुडे द बर्थ ऑफ अ वेरी टॉल इंडियन लीडर। Nandini ji has been celebrated by the Odisha Assembly as a lifelong revolutionary and by many others as an administrative genius. Now, to me, initially when I thought about it, these two things seemed very different from each other. But actually, when you look at what the rule of law truly means, these are the two factors that it requires us to bring together. Why is that? Let us think at the first instance, what rule of law is. Why does it exist? It exists to balance power from the mighty towards the landless, towards Dalits, towards OBCs, towards women, towards the 80% versus the 20% who do not have power. We could look around us and, you know, it's interesting. When I was a child, there was a perception that when you grow up, you can only do what your mother does and not your father, what your father does. So a lot of the people around me wanted to be, and my mother worked, you know, a lot of the people around me wanted to be teachers and physiotherapists, etc. And people did not think you could be a doctor, you could be a lawyer, you could be a judge. Because I looked around me and on the bench, there were Savarna, Hindu, upper class, privileged, able-bodied, heterosexual men. I looked around me at NGOs and it was the same situation. I looked around me in other positions of power, same thing. And has the position changed today? It has not changed that dramatically. And so what we have at the moment is that we have in governance, and you know, the Women's Reservation Bill is something that people have been trying to pass for ages, but it has not gone. So we still have a situation where we have about, let's say, 15 to 20% of society governing the rest of us. This is where power is wielded. Now, true freedom, true equality, this is the difference between the constitution that we have today and the ideals that we have today and what rule of law is supposed to be. This is where it is different, and this is where I actually disagree with you a little bit. Where this is where, you know, where traditional society, yes, there was the idea of rule of law was not there perhaps because it is something that was imposed from the outside back then. And there were particular structures that we had. We had the caste system and we had a particular place for women and we had, you know, ruling by a divine right and then ruling by a colonial power. But what are the ideals now? The ideals are different. I am going to tell three stories. Three stories of cases that I have worked on and experiences that I have had, and take stock of where we are as a society, how much progress we have made, in part through some of these cases, in part through other work, and how far do we have to go? Where is it that we have to go? The first story is the story of Zafrin Khan. Zafrin Khan suffered. She is a 23-year-old and she lives in Bhopal. Zafrin Khan suffered her first tragedy long before she was born. On the 9th of December the 2nd in 1984, a gas leak from the Union Carbide factory partially blinded her mother, gave her father chronic heart disease, and her brother, who was 2 years old at the time, developed lung problems. Safreen's second tragedy began when her family moved to a new house in a place called Gupta Nagar. They soon discovered that their water was laced with the same poisons that caused the 1984 tragedy. They were drinking hexachlorohexanes, dichlorobenzene. These cause cancer, neurotoxicity. She knew it could damage her lungs, her brain, and her reproductive system, but she had no option. Because the successive governments at the time, the Congress and the BJP governments, did not provide safe water. The 20,000 people who've been drinking this water for 30 years were forgotten too. Now, in terms of 32 years after the fact, 32 years after foreign companies came and created what is the poster child of industrial disaster, where are we? There have been a few victories. I argued a case in the Supreme Court for many years, leading a bunch of very committed activists and five survivors groups out of the seven that currently are there. And the court ordered that safe water be provided. It doesn't sound like much for the government to provide safe water, where water with chemicals is being provided to Bhopal victims. But it took us many, many years to do this. And the reason it took many years is that repeatedly, the Madhya Pradesh government would come and say, but it's all done. On affidavit, they would come and say, but the work is complete. Now, this is not a controversial subject of damages. This is just a matter of safe water being provided, you see. And every time, the survivors and their supporters would have to go back and do household surveys and say that, These people are still drinking cancer-causing water. These people are still drinking neurotoxic water. This work has been done. That is something of a victory. Now, the second victory, we got what was called and hailed then as a landmark judgment on providing better health care to these communities. That judgment is being now in the High Court. People are having to fight to have that implemented against these same denials that are coming again and again and again. Let us now talk about the money, the compensation that the survivors did not get. Since we are talking about rule of law, I'm going to trace this, of course, through the law. What happened in 1984, shortly thereafter, was that a Bhopal Claims Act was passed by the government appropriating the claims of the survivors and saying that, look, we will do a better job of bringing you justice. What justice was brought? In 1989, there was a midnight settlement that was made between the Congress government at the time and the companies. The survivors were not asked for their consent. The settlement was for a tiny percentage of the claim that was sought. In 2010, however, there was a public outcry because what happened was that the lower court said that a lower court convicted the Indian officials that were responsible for the negligence and the strip down of the safety mechanisms in the Union Carbide plant, and they convicted them for 2 years. 2 years. 2 years that is equal to a traffic accident without intention, drunk driving, where a misled boy runs over one person. Following this big public outcry, yes, the UPA government, they did file a curative petition. In that curative petition, they did an all right job, but a number of issues were left out. Issues concerning whether Dow Chemicals was liable, because Dow Chemicals was saying that, oh, but we only took over Union Carbide in 2001. Yes, it was a merger, and yes, we have acquired the rights, but we have not acquired the liabilities of this company. What was left out was the New York law, the Delaware law, all the fine legal principles that, of course, the companies would fight because they have the most sophisticated lawyers, but our government didn't see fit to address. We were impleaded as parties, and the five survivors groups, we worked, and a bunch of people from around the world came and worked very hard, and we have addressed those principles. That matter is before the court. They have said that they will look at the settlement and the validity of the settlement. So that is something of a partial victory. So in the end, unfortunately, what is it that we have got? We are at a stage where the Supreme Court, we hope, will hear the matter soon. But in response to our pleadings, Dow Carbide have filed about 6 feet worth of documents. This is something that is worth a lot of money to them. The central BJP government, what they have done in response is they have filed 8 pages, less than this. It is left to us then to fill those gaps too. It is left to some of the weakest, some of the poorest, some of the most disadvantaged in our country, their supporters and their lawyers, to fill those gaps. And we are working hard to do so. What it takes, though, let's face it, is yes, it takes this hard work, but it is the public outcry, it is the political support, let us not forget, that even got the UPA government to try and remedy the wrongs that the Congress made in the midnight settlement of the 1980s. And it is this involvement, it is this public voice, it is all of us standing together that makes a huge difference in these matters. You know, sometimes people ask me, why did this take 32 years? And I think that if this had happened in South Delhi or South Bombay, the answer would be very different. The result would be very different. Dow Carbide are able to hire sophisticated lobbyists and PR managers. They had donated some money to the BJP. It was not a large amount, but it was taken. Apparently, much later, there was a public outcry. It was given back. But it is also true that in our country, rule of law is somewhat thin on the ground. Now, of course, law is the most important thing that ultimately that governs our relationship with each other. Violence, property, commercial relationships, our relationships with companies, our relationship with government, it is something that governs the relationships. The trouble is that the wheels of justice grind slowly, and not just in human rights cases. India is one of the worst-ranked countries in enforcement of contracts. It's number 178 out of 188 countries. India is lower placed than Niger, Guinea-Bissau, the Kyrgyz Republic. They all fare better. Let's look then at the ease of doing business. This brings me to another client of mine, Vishal. Vishal is a bright and idealistic young man, and he came back from the US not wanting to join his father's business. He said, I'm trained as an engineer, I'm going to do something different. So what Vishal did was he started a business in water purifiers. Soon enough, an excise tax inspector came around, and Vishal claimed that one of that team asked him for a bribe. Vishal refused to give that bribe. He said, I'm an honest person, I'm a talented person, I'm a hardworking person, so I am going to fight this out. Because of course there were consequences and they acted against him. Now the problem was this. The problem was that yes, we won in the Supreme Court. The trouble was that it took 15 years. Now, in that 15 years, Vishal, who was a first generation entrepreneur in this area, did not have the staying power. And that business did not survive. Vishal had to go back to his family and start working with them. It was one of the least satisfying cases to win. It was a case of operation successful, patient dead, is what we call it. So Chief Justice Thakur's anguish when he was talking about the fact that we don't have enough infrastructure, we don't have enough judges, we don't have enough courtrooms, and we don't have enough people to staff the infrastructure of justice, I think was a very important one. Yes, there are also vacancies that need to be filled, but these boring, nitty-gritty issues, having enough courts, making sure about 70% of the people in jails are not convicted of anything at all. So speed of justice is something that's extremely important. It is speedy, certain justice that prevents, for example, sexual assault. Not the death penalty, not higher sentences. It is speedy, certain justice. You know, we keep talking about India being a democracy, and China has not established the rule of law. And if there is a power above the law, there is no social justice, apparently. Everybody can be subjected to harm. This is something that Ai Weiwei said. An elite class that is free to operate without limits, power that is free to operate without limits, only gets strengthened when that power is replicated in the legal system of a country. When you have a police force, judges that are, and a judiciary, when you have, when it is not sufficiently representative of the population that it seeks to serve, when you have about, it was, the rate of women constables was about 5% in 2011, it's gone up a bit now, but not very significantly. When you have power concentrated in these ways that it is wielded in a manner that it does not further constitutional principles, in fact goes against constitutional principles, then that leads to misrule. One of the problems, of course, is the fact that at the first instance, we have laws and decisions that are made by parliament and government that are, at the outset, unconstitutional. I don't know if any of you remember the Shaheen Dhada case, when she was on Facebook making a comment about when Bal Thackeray passed away. Do any of you remember that? You remember that? What she said was this. She said, Mumbai shuts down out of fear, not out of respect. Now, you may agree, you may disagree, you may have a problem with it, you may not, but should the girl go to jail? What happened was this. She put this on Facebook. She was 20 in her early 20s. Her friend Renu Srinivasan liked it. Now, those of you who are not familiar with the internet, liking something is a bit like nodding. Like, you know, I'm saying something, somebody nodded. It's a bit like that. Right? There was a law that said that anything that is annoying or inconvenient, without definition, annoying or inconvenient, that is said on the internet, can send someone to jail for 3 years. Now, you know, initially when I saw this law, I thought, like, this can't possibly be implemented. It's too silly. You know, this can't be passed. It was passed. Once it was passed, I thought it won't be used. It was used. It was used frequently. But where it was used was very interesting, because it was used by people with political power across the board. Across the board. In Kolkata, a Jadavpur professor who had made a joke about Mamata Banerjee, honestly, it wasn't very funny, but it wasn't so disrespectful. It wasn't really disrespectful or problematic in a sexist way. And it didn't violate any laws because the court dropped all the laws except for the Section 66A. Karthi Chidambaram brought a case against someone for talking about disproportionate assets. In Bombay, the Shiv Sena gathered outside of Shaheen Dhada's uncle clinic and destroyed it. And who gets arrested? The young girl. Ultimately, after a long and tough battle in which many people were involved in the Supreme Court, this law, the Supreme Court decided to strike it down. But it's not that it was an open and shut case. We had to argue, and we had to argue hard. Let us also be clear that when government does not act constitutionally at the first instance, the court cannot always fix it. Why is that? Because the ambit of constitutional determination of a court is not as wide as we think. If you have an entire legislation that Parliament sees fit to pass that is unconstitutional, and if you bring that entire legislation before the Supreme Court or before a High Court, it is almost impossible for that bench to strike the entire legislation down. What that bench might do is they might say that, you know, challenge particular sections before us. If you can find a constitutional rights lawyer to bring this case, and within a particular ambit, the judge may decide to at an extreme level strike it down, but they may also read it down. But if you look, for example, at Section 377, it's not that easy. If you look, for example, at the patently illegal, constantly patently illegal decisions that the Central Board for Film Certification makes, for example, with Urta Punjab, it is a board for certification and not for, it is not a board for cuts. But these are decisions that are made repeatedly. What is it that Mr. Nihalani said? Mr. Nihalani said that this is a film that is defamatory. And I quote, that it is defamatory to the state. Of course, the fact that a state cannot be defamed under the Rajagopal judgment, or indeed, I mean, it is not possible for a state, has had escaped his attention, as well as perhaps the attention of his legal advisors. But what happens? It means that every time such a thing happens, every time government cracks down on free speech, or on somebody's rights, or passes a bad law, the onus is on the individual citizen to go to court, to find a constitutional lawyer, and for the courts to be then be burdened and decide this matter within a particular limited ambit. So the rule of law, I think now, is truly something that we need to absorb. We need to absorb as a society what our constitutional rights are. And what our constitutional rights are, we need to implement them in our daily lives, in the boundaries that we have between each other, and we need to fight for them with institutions, before governments, and we need to claim our power and also establish the boundaries between our power and the power of others. It is a second independence movement now that is required. What we had so far was independence from British rule, but what Baba Sahib Ambedkar said even back then is that until every individual has the freedoms and the equalities and the basic rights that are guaranteed by our constitution, India will not be free. Thank you.
Good question, Asichi. Move through quickly, jatikita parili, shortlist kali. ଗୋଟିଏ ପ୍ରଥମ ପ୍ରଶ୍ନ ପ୍ରାଣକୃଷ୍ଣ ଦଳ ବେହେରା ଜଣେ ଆଡ଼ଭୋକେଟ୍ ପ୍ରାଣକୃଷ୍ଣ ବାବୁ ଇଜ୍ ଆସ୍କିଂ ଇଜ୍ ଏନ୍ ଆଡ଼ଭୋକେଟ୍ ଫ୍ରମ୍ ଖୋର୍ଦ୍ଧା ୱିଚ୍ ଇଜ୍ କ୍ଲୋଜ୍ ଟୁ ଭୁବନେଶ୍ୱର ହି ହାଜ୍ ଏ କ୍ୱେଶ୍ଚନ୍ ଫର୍ ମିସ୍ ଫ୍ଲାଭିଆ ଆଗ୍ନେସ୍ ୱେଦର କାଷ୍ଟ କଲ୍ଚର୍ ଇନ୍ ହିନ୍ଦୁ ସୋସାଇଟି ଇଜ୍ ରେସ୍ପନ୍ସିବଲ୍ ଫର୍ ଅନର୍ କିଲିଂ ଡାଉରୀ ଡିମାଣ୍ଡ suicide by married Hindu women as well as child marriage or economical inequality in is responsible for such said incidents?
I think it is the tradition and culture that is responsible more than the economic inequalities. Like for instance, dowry death. They marry within the same economic strata and same caste strata, and yet dowry harassment, dowry killings happens. So how come you say economic inequalities? Or if you say honor killings, the honor killings happens when upper class girl falls in love with a lower caste. So wherever there are very rigid caste barriers and caste inequalities, that it happens. In Maharashtra, it is basically Maratha, land-owning Maratha farming class, who also are politically very influential. And it happens between the lower class, which is the Mahar community. So we cannot say it is happens because class inequality, but I think it is the whole tradition and culture and contempt for the lower class caste that happens. And we have not been, though Ambedkar is from Maharashtra, and there's a strong Dalit rights movement there, we have not been able to transcend that, and still the situation persists.
In Dharmendra Hemamalini episode, you missed the fact that Dharmendra converted to Islam before marrying Hemamalini. Doesn't the opportunistic act of the actor bring credence to the chorus that there should be implementation of uniform civil code in the country?
That is not true. This whole myth that if you marry and become Hindu, Muslim, that you don't have to follow your personal laws. It's totally myth and it's a misconception projected by the media. If you're married under Hindu law, you have to have a divorce under Hindu law. And we have a very important judgment here of 1995, which says that by conversion, you don't leave your marriage and marital obligations. Though it is like shown that, you know, like if you marry, if you're a Muslim, you can marry 4 times. No, you have to fulfill your obligations to each of your wives under Muslim law. But your marriage was under Hindu law. So you have to dissolve that marriage under Hindu law. And neither Dharmendra was never Muslim before or afterwards. It is a sham marriage between when a Hindu converts. Hindu will do anything. We have cases where the Hindu doesn't take 7 steps. He only takes 6 steps. So he says the seven steps are not taken, so there is no marriage here. So converting to Islam is only one of the pretexts. There are 100 different pretexts a Hindu man follows. But can it be that a Hindu, for the sake of marriage, becomes a Hindu, Muslim, marries a Hindu girl who also converts, and then gets back to Hinduism and practices Hinduism? Is it our case that Dharmendra is a Muslim today? Is it our case that Hema Malini is a Muslim today? Or is it just a ploy that we are adopting and conveniently using for something else, that there should be uniform civil code? How can it be possible? Only a Muslim can marry under Muslim law. Only a Hindu can marry under Hindu law. And a Hindu must divorce his Hindu wife under Hindu law and then become a practicing Muslim in order for him to qualify as a Muslim man to qualify a Muslim wife into marriage. Otherwise, it's not possible at all.
That question was by Subhaprada Mahanti. Last one for you, ma'am. Whether you think more laws are required for women in the present society. This is by someone called Bana Mahanti.
I don't think more laws are required. What I feel is implementation of the laws is required, and we don't have implementation. Passing new laws has become a fancy. For every damn thing, we want a new law, a campaign for law, and everybody votes for a new law, and we have a new law. What that law has done and what it's doing at the ground level, we never pause to think what effect it has, how it has changed the situation. Just to give you an example, after the Delhi gang rape, we had a new law, Criminal Amendment Act, which broadened the definition. And we all asked for like death penalty. Death penalty came also. What is the effect of it on the ground level? Has it brought down the rape cases in the country? Or are we, just before that, we had a law curbing child sexual abuse. Has it really brought down child sexual abuse in the country? Every day we're reading reports in the papers that rape cases are increased, child sexual abuse cases are increased. So, and is there conviction under these laws? Firstly, this takes a long time, but at the end of it, do we have conviction? So we, all the time, one case happens, and the Delhi case also, there's a class element here. A middle class girl getting raped by lower class boys. Similarly, we had Shakti Mills case in Mumbai. So these cases, there is death penalty. Does it bring down rape cases in the country? Does it act as a deterrent at all? So we constantly asking for new laws, hoping that new laws will bring social change. It doesn't bring social change, according to me.
Thank you. Karuna ma'am, there's a few questions for you.
Here's the point where we do disagree. And I have the greatest respect for Ms. Agnes and, you know, the work that you've been doing for all these years. But however, I think that a number of our laws are deeply patriarchal. In 2013, I was one of the people with a number of other people that worked with the government to bring some of the provisions of these new laws.
I was also one of the people and also made recommendations.
Right.
That doesn't mean that law is unworkable.
So what do these new laws do? What these new laws did, and this is where we first met. I don't know if you remember. We first met at an NDTV debate at 9 p.m. just the day of the discussion in Parliament. Stalking became a crime that day. Voyeurism became a crime that day. It was not a crime before. Before, a man who constantly followed a woman and she felt threatened, she felt she might be murdered, she felt she might be raped, it was perfectly legal. In Parliament that day, Sharad Yadav stood up and he said, and I can't remember precisely what the words were, but it was like, "Arey, hum to college mein karte the. This is something we used to do in college." You know? So, the problem is that there's a lot of patriarchy that is normalized, and it's in, and that a lot of that patriarchy is in our laws. So if you look at the Indian Penal Code now, it is a combination of Victorian morality, this arbitrary Victorian morality that we seem to have inherited for some reason because of colonialism, and it's not been gotten rid of contemporary patriarchy, because for example, stalking is only non-bailable on the second offense. So the boy has to keep following you repeatedly, not once, but twice. And also, it is some progressive values that people like him fight for in Parliament and people like us work for in other ways. So now, you know, the thing is that if you even look at divorce law, now there's a lot of illusion that, you know, since you were talking about Hindu women, I think I completely agree with everything she said there. You know, Hindu women, the idea, when women get divorced, there's this idea that, oh, but I'm contributing to the family and I may not be getting half of the income now, where there was actually a bill that the UPA had proposed. But when I get divorced, of course, if I get divorced, not when I get, nobody wants to get divorced. But if I get divorced, I'll get what's fair, maybe I won't get half the property, maybe I'll get 30%. Not the case. The right is to maintenance and the right is to a portion of property in joint names. So this is something that a lot of women don't realize. So it's very, very patriarchal, even the way the law is now.
I was kind of heckled in Parliament by a very senior parliamentarian, what Ms. Nandi is referring to, where I objected to the gentleman who got up and said, "Kya ho gaya? हम तो जब कॉलेज में पढ़ते थे लड़कियों को हर रोज छेड़ते थे. सो दिस वाज लाइक आई मीन इन द ऑन द फ्लोर ऑफ द इंडियन पार्लियामेंट अ वेरी सीनियर पार्लियामेंटेरियन एडमिटिंग दैट ही वाज हैरेसिंग गर्ल्स व्हाइल ही वाज इन कॉलेज स्कूल एंड कॉलेज ऑन अ डेली बेसिस. सो व्हाई हैव अ लॉ फॉर दैट? पनिश हिम? क्रेजी? सो इट मेक्स Yeah, right. You have to harass them to get them. We went the other way around, all of us. Anyway, okay. For Karunanandi ma'am, we shall not take too long. Mr. Siddharth Das asks, does the victim compensation scheme in section 437A CRPC, my God, he must be a lawyer. So he asks to Karunanandi ma'am, does the victim compensation scheme in section 437A CRPC, which I don't understand, really solve the problem of victims in India? Part 2, isn't the due process of law followed in India, Indian courts take too long to provide justice, and by the time the aggrieved party more often than not is dead to enjoy the fruit of justice? So first part is important. Does it solve the problem of does victim compensation scheme in section 437A CRPC, does it really solve the problem, you think? Compensation, you know, is it enough?
As you may know, the Criminal Law Amendment Bill of 2013, that's one of the issues that it addressed. However, the problem is that a lot of the states haven't set up these schemes, you see. So in a lot of the states, these schemes don't even exist. Also, in terms of the process required to get that compensation, that process can be complicated. Now, in terms of how long does it take to, how long does any legal process take? As you know, there are property cases that take decades, you know, like the grandson is inheriting it. You have even rape convictions that are, of course, the right to appeal, you know, has to be there. But at the same time, there is a study that was done by, this is slightly off topic and I'll come back, it was a study that was done by Professor Mrinal Satish at Yale. And what they found was this, that if you are raped and you are a virgin, then the rapist gets a high sentence.
If the woman is raped and she is married, he gets a slightly lower sentence. And if she is unmarried and, you know, the forensic test, this sort of crazy two-finger test that is nowhere medically reliable, or, you know, that she, it creeps into the forensic report and comes before the judge, and the judge thinks she may have had some prior sexual intercourse, then that rapist gets an even lower sentence, you see? So yes, in terms of justice, it is true that it is extremely slow. We need more judges, we need more courts, we need more police, etc. But at the same time, it is the patriarchy also in all of this implementation. It is the anti-constitutionality that needs to be changed. And that is a different issue. That there are a number of ways that need to be addressed, but that is equally important.
One last question. This is by Mr. J.P. Mahapatra. It is said that justice delayed is justice denied. But at the same time, justice hurried is justice buried. Please explain, to get the justice delivered to the needy people, how can it be done at the right speed and in the right manner?
I can see Mr. Mahapatra likes sayings. Where is Mr. Mahapatra? Hello. Look, to some extent I agree with you, because, for example, fast-track courts, the idea of fast-track courts, very often you have courts that are regular courts that sit as fast-track courts. And sometimes you get convictions that are so fast that on appeal they are more frequently in any case overturned, you see. So there's no point then getting that conviction at the first instance. In terms of speedier justice, yes, of course we need more judges. Of course, I mean, I keep saying this, but we need more judges, we need more courts, and we need more police. And the second thing is that we need more women judges, we need more judges of different castes, we need more judges of, for example, I think that at the moment, you know, we have three judges from a particular community, from a particular state in the Supreme Court. You know, from one jati. So now this is something that that does need to change. And what does it take? Whose responsibility is it? This is the responsibility of government primarily, of government. It is the government that creates the new posts, etc. And of course, the posts that are still vacant need to be filled. But I keep hearing, you know, wherever I go, wherever I speak to people, I keep hearing this problem that people have of delayed justice. One thing I would also say is that, you know, Maldives advising the government and the Supreme Court there, and they are kind of building their system, legal system, from the ground up. So one of the things that we, you know, after various sort of deep consultations, but the population is only 350,000, one of the things we recommended is mediation. Finding a way to understand each other's legal responsibility, you know, through lawyers and through consultation. And then coming to, you know, taking the cost that it would take to hire a lawyer, to the money forfeited for the next, whatever, 15 years that you can see go through the court system, have a realistic estimate of where you are in your position, and then see if you can come to a reasonable settlement. You know, very often we see property cases that happened between two brothers because one wife insulted the brother, and therefore, you know, acting what looks like something that is a land dispute is actually a question of two people fighting, and they need to figure it out, you know? And sometimes, and you know, I'm a Supreme Court appointed mediator, and we had to do a number of cases in the trial courts as practice. And there are times that we found that 12-year-old disputes sort of disappeared in two sessions of 45 minutes. So yeah, I would say we need to also understand our legal rights, and we need to just sort it out between ourselves also sometimes.
Thank you.
Dhanyabad. Yete samara alochana bhitare ame bodhe ei niskarsh re pahunchiba jaha ajira mukhya atithi Karunanandi kahi charichanti. Puni apan manku sei kotha di mone pakai debi jaha Shri Krishna kahithile Arjuna ko je tumar jodi nijo prapya jaha taku paiba pai लड़े करार साहस नहीं ताल जहाँ पाइल नहीं कांद नपाई कांदार अधिकार भी ना जदि कांदुव लड़े नक अहल्या पथर ही पड़ थ अपेक्षा करमचंद्र कौदिन आसब आईन जदि रामचंद्र हुए ताकु साथीरे धरी समस्त विश्वामित्र ही से पथर निकट को जीवा पड़ो एवं अहल्या उद्धार करने पड़ो। आईन अच्छी, आईन आमपाई अच्छी, आम आईन महत्व बुझा बोध हुए आज निष्कर्ष आम ये बुझे समस्त को पुणि थे धन्यवाद जनाऊँ एवं पारंपरिक ता दृष्टि आमर जहाँ सौजन्य आमर जहाँ परंपरा से हिसाब से आम अतिथि की आम स्नेह उपहार प्रदान करूँ मु अनुरोध करी धरित्री एवं ओडिशा पोस्टर संपादक श्रीजुक्त तथागत शतपथी महोदय को प्रथम आज मुख्य अतिथि करुणानंदी महोदय को उपढ़ोकन एवं स्मृति फलक प्रदान करेंगे। आम संबर्धित करूँ आज मुख्य अतिथि क्लाविया एग्नेस को धन्यवाद।
समस्त पुनर्वार धन्यवाद दौची समस्ते निरवतार सहित बसिले। थैंक यू वंस अगेन। नमस्कार। जय हिंद।